David Dayen is a reporter for The Intercept, The Nation, and countless other magazines. You're a pretty great writer, and you have a couple of pieces in The Nation that I want to talk to you about. One is about Sinclair Media. They're a conservative TV network. They own all the local stations, and I guess the FCC is going to allow them to purchase Tribune?
Yeah. So Tribune Media, which once held the LA Times and Chicago Tribune, but then sort of split off the newspaper business from their television business. That's a company that owns WGN and I believe PIX in New York and KTLA out here in Los Angeles, and about 42 stations all across the country.
These are big stations.
Big stations in the biggest media markets.
Right.
Sinclair owns far more stations. Sinclair actually owns 173 television stations, most of them in small and mid-sized markets. So they're a bit under the radar. And this acquisition would give them a foothold in 70% of the country. And we're talking about local television stations, which all of which produce local news broadcasts. And you talk about local news, and you know people think, well, nobody outside of their people in their 80s listen to watch local news. Not true. It's actually it remains the number one source for people who get their news. You don't think about it too much, but particularly in areas where this is kind of the only game in town, local news remains an important source of information for people. That might be scary to say, but it's true. And Sinclair has a penchant for using this power to present a significantly biased set of opinions, biased in the conservative direction.
Like back in 2004.
That's right. So, a couple things came up back in 2004. First, Sinclair, they're affiliates of all sorts of television stations, from ABC to CBS to NBC. Sinclair's ABC stations refused to air an episode of Nightline that merely listed the names of Iraqi war dead. That was seen as too controversial for Sinclair-owned stations. Then, during the election campaign between John Kerry and George W. Bush, Sinclair said that they were going to air a two-hour documentary produced by the Swift Boat Veterans for Truth that called into question John Kerry's military service. And they were going to force it on all of their stations without commercial interruption and in prime time 2 weeks before the election. I mean, this is clear electioneering on the part of Sinclair on behalf of George W. Bush.
What are the laws about that?
Well, there was tremendous outcry. We didn't really get to the laws because there was such public outcry and, in fact, a concerted effort to tank the Sinclair stock, that they backed off and they only ran portions of this documentary along with, sort of a broader discussion, although it wasn't that much broader because there was about 30 minutes of the Kerry documentary and about 3 minutes on George W. Bush's service with the Texas Air National Guard. There aren't really too many laws to answer your question about this anymore, not since the disappearance of the Fairness Doctrine, which was a previous law that forced some manner of equality in public affairs programming in terms of opinions. But that is no longer with us, and so you have Sinclair that's able to, very quietly put together a very conservative news source. Now, you know how local news works is these are cash-strapped stations. They're always starved for content. And Sinclair produces content and basically tells its affiliates to run it all over the country. So it's the effect of a national news network, a la a Fox News, but it's being done at the local news level where people don't really have that thinking that there's some sort of bias to their local news programming. Mm-hmm.
Don't they have a corporate executive at Sinclair who delivers editorials right
now? That's correct. That's correct.
And they're must-runs, right?
They're must-runs. Their chief Washington political analyst actually served in the Trump administration for a little while. There's a guy named Boris Epstein. He was a surrogate mm-hmm. for the Trump campaign.
Yeah.
And yes, their vice president, I believe, delivers editorials that are must-run. Even if these weren't must-run, they're content, you know? It's like free content for these news stations. They're going to take it. So, you know, it creates this situation where all over the country, people are watching their local news, not expecting to be sort of indoctrinated in any way, and they're getting all this very one-sided set of news and information. And that went right down to the Trump-Clinton general election, where Sinclair reportedly made a deal with Jared Kushner to get expanded access for the Trump campaign on these local news stations that were owned by Sinclair. And Sinclair said, you let us interview the president or the presidential candidate at that time, Trump, or your top advisors, and we'll just run it. And we won't give any commentary whatsoever. This was sort of an unmediated filter directly into these local news stations, which, as I said, is a key source of news and might even have more credibility than a national news source, which, you know, there's all these accusations of bias on a Fox News or even on the other side. But, you know, this was a way to get these things on the local news, which just isn't seen that way. And it was obviously pretty successful. I believe the CEO of Sinclair Broadcasting rode on in the presidential inaugural parade. So there's clearly a close relationship here. And what's important to understand is that Sinclair, just a few months ago, would not have been able to make this deal with Tribune that gives them this 70% you know, footprint over the country's news viewers. And the reason is that laws were changed at the Federal Communications Commission, which had previously clamped down on the amount of stations one company could own or the amount of stations one company could own in a particular market.
We're getting ahead of ourselves for 1 second.
Okay.
Because I do want to talk about the FCC.
Yes.
But I want to get back to what I would assume you would call the astroturf of local news, in that Sinclair is presenting what appears to be a grassroots opinion in a small town market,
right?
But it's secretly being dictated by a corporate overlord in
Baltimore. Just think about it, David. I mean, when you're watching ABC in Lincoln, Nebraska, you have no idea that that is a station that's owned by Sinclair Broadcasting. You just know it's ABC. There's no you know, recognition of this link between this right-wing propagandist and the local news that you're watching on your television.
If anything, you think you're watching ABC News.
That's correct. And you get and that credibility is sort of lent over to that local news outlet.
So the prestidigitation that's going on and the brainwashing that is going on is you live in Lincoln, Nebraska, you're watching a local television station that's owned by Sinclair, but it identifies itself as an ABC affiliate. It's running ABC content all day.
Correct. Yep.
So you think, oh, it's part of the liberal media, but it's owned by Sinclair, which has nothing to do with ABC. So they're running ABC network news, but they're using their local news to push their conservative agenda, making it look like it's homegrown.
Right. And wow. Now when, you know, when some people looked at this Sinclair purchase of Tribune and all of these additional stations, they thought, oh, here we go. Sinclair is going to create their answer to Fox News. They're going to create a more conservative network, you know, pick up Bill O'Reilly, or they're going to do something like that. The truth is they don't need to. They've got the perfect thing going right now because it's just as you described. They borrow the credibility of these broadcast networks. They run their affiliate local news. They pipe in all of this very slanted programming into the news product that goes next to your local sports and weather. And they benefit from having this sort of unfiltered pipeline that doesn't have this any kind of understanding or recognition of bias on the part of the viewer that's able to put this agenda forward. It's really quite ingenious.
It's scary because we are a nation incapable of critical thinking.
Right.
And I don't mean to sound condescending, but it's true. You said two things, and they don't make sense. You say that these local stations are cash-strapped, but they're owned by Sinclair, so
right.
They're cash.
Oh, I see what you mean.
Yeah,
they're well, the news budgets are. I mean, you know, you
that's
have
self-inflicted,
these local
though, right?
Absolutely. I mean, you know, certainly they could raise the product of the news value on those stations, but you know, I mean, in the modern era, news has to bring a profit. In the previous era, news didn't have to be a cash cow for any network. So, you know, most local news budgets, they don't have the budget to go out and have their own reporter in Washington, for example. They don't have the budget to have an international bureau. No local news program has that sort of budget. So that's kind of what I mean by cash strap.
Yeah.
So they are pleased to have a corporate partner that's able to give them that level of news programming in you know, decently produced packages that they can just roll into their news, 11 o'clock news, and eat up that 2 to 3 minutes of time. I mean, this is really helpful for a local news station that has to be mindful of costs, because it's simply the case that their budgets do not allow them to do, you know, massive amounts of national broadcasting and news gathering.
Earlier you said Sinclair was publicly traded.
It is, yeah.
And do we know if it's profitable?
It's wildly profitable. You're talking about a company that owns and operates hundreds of these television stations, you know, which are able to bring in all kinds of ad revenue. You know, think of how many television stations there are in a community. I'm talking about local television stations. I mean, it's not like there's a lot of choice there, right? So whoever it is that owns them has the ability to really put a big mark, you know, upon that market. And in some places, they have more than one station in a given market.
Now, there was a time when that was not allowed by the FCC. You weren't allowed to own two stations. Let me tell
you.
Now you
can own two, but not more than two. However, all of this could change in our new great and glorious Trump era.
Let me filter it through something I experienced when I was young and TV was black and white. When I moved to San Francisco, I worked for KRON, which was at
right.
the time the NBC
affiliate. Right?
The NBC
yeah.
affiliate, and it was pretty much one of their flagship stations. It wasn't owned and operated by NBC, but they were very proud of mm-hmm. their news organization because it was owned by the Chronicle family, the San Francisco Chronicle.
Sure.
Something happened. I don't remember what it was. But the Chronicle had to sell KRON because they weren't allowed to own.
This is why Tribune broke up. You weren't allowed to own a television station and a newspaper in the same market, I think is the deal.
And it was because they didn't want one family influencing
right.
a municipality.
Which is good public policy.
There was a time when foreigners could not own a TV station.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It was the great Senator Ted Kennedy who was instrumental in lifting the ban on foreigners owning television stations so that Rupert Murdoch
right.
could buy Fox television, right?
Interestingly, Fox was the other bidder in this process for Tribune Media. They lost to Sinclair.
And what is the thinking? We don't allow foreign governments to contribute to the Trump campaign, supposedly. And
right.
there was a time when we didn't want foreign governments owning television and radio stations. What were they afraid of?
Well, I think basically the government has walked off the field with respect to all of these things, particularly antitrust concerns and concerns of foreign ownership. In the Constitution, the president can't be born in a foreign country. There was long-standing suspicion, you could even say xenophobia over these kinds of matters. My personal view is not that foreign ownership necessarily represents something that should be feared and should, you know, give us concern. It's the concentration of power, in my view, that is a far more important issue at this point. And this is the area where Trump's FCC is operating to try to concentrate and consolidate media ownership more than we've seen in generations.
I want to get to the FCC in a second, but I want to get back to cash-strapped newsrooms across America, because journalism is a sacred trust. We can't have a democracy with a well-informed electorate. We no longer have a well-informed electorate. The Russians are able to hack the DNC and spread disinformation. And because, as I said earlier, we are incapable of critical thinking. We can't tell what's real and what's fake. The justification for firing people at newspapers and in local television newsrooms is we are cash strapped.
Right.
Are television newsrooms, our local stations, really cash strapped? And for example, the Los Angeles Times,
right,
which was owned by Mr. Zell from the Tribune, they were told we're cash strapped. But wasn't it really the...
You're talking about a few different things there. If you're talking about newspapers and journalism, print journalism, it is the case that print journalism advertising has reduced significantly over the last 20 years, and it's concurrent with the rise of the Internet and the changes in that advertising. And that is a monopoly problem as well, something we're going to get into later, I think, in the show,
yeah,
about the fact that Google and Facebook have cornered the advertising markets online,
mm-hmm.
and, about 88% of them are in the hands of those two companies, and they can dictate what the actual producers of journalism can receive in terms of advertising. And this has significantly constrained the ability of these newsrooms to survive with the same number of journalists that they had in the past and do the kind of very expensive enterprise reporting that had been their hallmark in the past. That's true to a lesser extent with television news, particularly at the broadcast level. I mean, you see less and less international bureaus, less and less, long-form, 60-minute style kind of enterprise reporting out of those outlets as well. It's a different dynamic in the television space. It was more about how, television news used to be a loss leader, and the entertainment programming is what made the money, and the television news outlet was the prestige part of that equation, and also it satisfied FCC requirements for public interest programming and public affairs programming and things like that. But those rules were relaxed. They were able to be fulfilled by other means. And over time, the owners of television news decided, well, the news has to pull its weight along with the entertainment programming. And that's just asking too much of television news, which, if you want to do it right, is also very expensive to produce. But it's certainly easier to throw up three talking heads and have them shout at each other. Mm-hmm. And that doesn't cost very much money at all, except for the camera and the microphone. So that really is how that all evolved. And then sort of the rise of cable news as a competitor drove the conversation, which much cheaper product.
I think it was in the 80s where CBS got bought out. I think it was Tisch, some tobacco magnate, who said, okay, news has to make a profit.
Right.
As I understood it, he said that because they discovered that news could make a profit, that 60 Minutes was number one, that there was money to be made with good, solid journalism.
Right. And that was certainly true in the case of 60 Minutes. I think what happened concurrently was sort of the rise of CNN, which had an international footprint, but also had a 24-hour news cycle to fill. And that became, sort of a less sustainable scenario. And then it was about the nightly news trying to compete with the 24-hour news that was on all the time. And figuring out how to do that the best. 60 Minutes was obviously, something that, like you said, was number one for a long time and commanded huge ad rates. But that was almost lightning in a bottle, wouldn't you say? I mean, nobody else really found that formula, whether it was, 2020 or some of these other programs, to really make that happen in such a way. And of course, what other news outlets could not do that 60 Minutes sort of as a legacy was allowed to do was really challenge corporate power, to really challenge the forces that shape our lives, and too much of programming, news programming, got influence, whether directly or indirectly, by advertisers.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at the nightly news, you'll see two major industries represented, pharmaceuticals or the defense industry,
right.
Because it's more about influencing what goes on the news than attracting, eyeballs to the advertising. This is like, it always amuses me when I walk through D.C. and you just see an entirely different kind of billboard advertising about niche bills. It's just intended to attract the eyes of the staffs of congressional representatives rather than any normal human being. And I think that's a lot what happened with television news.
If the Justice Department enforced, I guess it's the Sherman Act, antitrust laws.
Yeah.
If the Justice Department protected communities from Wall Street, all radio stations, or most, and most television stations, would be locally owned. And as I recall, before they relaxed these ownership rules, I think it was the Telecommunications Act of 96 or 97, there was a time when if you owned a radio station, a television station locally, and even a newspaper, because they were enforcing antitrust laws, it was a cash cow. It was an absolute cash cow. What role does debt play in the decimation of the newsroom? The Los Angeles Times was a cash cow, but this guy Zell bought it and racked up all this debt.
Right. Well, that was almost a private equity play.
You know?
I mean, that's kind of what they do. They take these companies private, they saddle them down with debt, and they use that as a means to extract value out of the corporation. That's because debt is preferred in the tax code over equity, and there are a whole variety of reasons. Oh, yeah, absolutely. There are a whole variety of reasons why private equity works. If you just change that debt wasn't preferred in the tax code, a lot of the financial engineering that we see out of private equity firms would go away.
I'm sorry, I didn't know this. So if I'm a private equity firm, I'm going to take a publicly held company.
Right.
Buy it out. I'm going to have to do
it. You're going to use debt to buy that out. And then you're going to place that debt upon the company, not upon your balance sheet, but upon the company's balance sheet. So the company then has to figure a way to dig out of that. And meanwhile, private equity takes its management fees from its private investors. It takes all these tax credits that you can get when you're using debt, because you can deduct interest and you can do all sorts of debt plays. It, you know, can sell the real estate underpinning the corporation and then lease it back to the particular corporation and make them pay rent on this thing that they used to own. There are all sorts of schemes that a private equity company can use that are just ways to leak profits out of a corporation. In the name of efficiency, in the name of, taking a failing company, so-called, and nursing it back to health, what they're really doing is field stripping that company for assets. And, I think you saw that, you know, with respect to the LA Times, with respect to what Sam Zell was doing. One thing I would add, though, is that there is a culprit for this, you know, lack of enforcement of antitrust, and it goes back to the 1980s. It actually goes back to a man named Robert Bork, who dodged a bullet with him not being a Supreme Court justice, which he almost was. He was nominated for that position by President Reagan. However, before that, in the 1970s, he became the most consequential figure in antitrust law in American history. Because without changing a word of the Sherman Antitrust Act, Robert Bork reinterpreted its meaning. Before Robert Bork, the idea behind the Sherman Antitrust Act was thought to be to prevent large companies from growing in size and dominating a particular field. And what Robert Bork did is said, nope, don't have to worry about size, don't have to worry about bigness, you don't have to worry about individuals who want to display their talents not having any company other than the main company that dominates a particular space to work for. All you have to worry about is consumer welfare. As long as prices go down, there is no problem with any company merging with any other company.
Wow.
So as long as the prices fall, that's all you have to think about. And that has that simple idea, which is not part of the Sherman Antitrust Act, has dominated the thinking around antitrust for the next 35 years.
Wow. How did he do it? What was he doing at the time?
He was teaching at Yale Law School. In fact, the day after the election this year, I was at the Yale Law School giving a speech on my book, and
which is now out.
I looked up in the room, and Robert Bork was looking back at me. That was the room that I was giving this talk in.
And I mean, there was a picture of him. There was a picture.
Yeah, giant portrait. He wrote a book called The Antitrust Paradox in the 1970s, and this reinvented what we know about antitrust law. And then the Reagan administration in the 1980s, they changed the guidance, the official guidance in the Justice Department for how to look at antitrust cases, largely adopting Robert Bork's view of the case. And that essentially took the antitrust enforcement off the beat. The country has really never been the same.
Wow, because it almost has become doctrine that you always hear, well, the merger was approved because the consumer will benefit from it.
Consumer will benefit, right. They talk about efficiency and consumer welfare. And that is not what John Sherman actually put in his law as what he wanted to safeguard against.
What was he trying to safeguard?
He was trying to stop bigness. He was trying to stop the domination of sectors by certain individuals and corporations and trusts that would have consequential outcomes for income and wealth concentration, which he talked about, personal liberty and the ability to, be an entrepreneur, the ability to, if you want to take your use your particular skills, that you can do that in an industry that isn't dominated by someone else, so you have a barrier to entry. There were all these other facets of the Sherman Antitrust Act that are not reflected in Robert Bork's interpretation, because what he did was he turned it from a legal case to an economic case. Because you can always find an economist to make the case that there is a consumer welfare benefit to a particular merger. I mean, it's just math that they do, and you can always sort of twist the statistics to make that case. Now, interestingly, there's some work that's been done recently that actually does a retrospective look at a lot of mergers and finds that prices actually do go up.
Of course.
After, these mergers happen.
Of course.
So the entire, even on Robert Bork's own terms, this consumer welfare idea is ridiculous. But it's especially ridiculous because he reinterpreted a 100-year-old law without changing a word of it legislatively, just through interpretive guidance, literally changed legal history.
As I see mergers and acquisitions, I can't compete with you. You're a threat to me. You're going to put me out of business. I'm going to buy you then fire everybody. And I'll take...
Right, that's the efficiency, right?
Yeah.
That's what's considered the efficiency. And you're absolutely right. And we have seen this now in sector after sector of our economy. In places you don't even think about. You go into a supermarket and you look down the aisle and there seems to be all these choices in front of you, and yet it's a handful of companies that own every one of those brands. Most of the toothpaste in this country comes from two brands. All of the eyeglasses in this country are made by one company.
Who's the company?
They're an Italian company called Luxottica. And they not only own the brands of eyeglasses, but they own the stores in which they're sold. I could go on and on and on about this, about the increasing market concentration. And we're finally starting to see a little pushback to Bork and what is called the Chicago School, the economists at the University of Chicago that really took up these ideas and adopted them. I was at a conference in Chicago, at the University of Chicago, in March, where it was a real consequential challenge to this notion of consumer welfare, to this notion that we don't have a problem with these large concentrations of wealth and power that we're seeing all throughout every economic sector. And so things are starting to change a little bit, but it's going to take a good amount of time. And obviously what we're seeing right now with the administration, the Trump administration has come in, is a sliding back.
The Chicago School was Hayek, Milton Friedman,
yep.
Strauss. These were people who...
Stigler, came up with the idea of regulatory capture.
And they believe, they gave us the shock doctrine, and they also gave us this belief in the free market, that there actually is a free market and it's pure. We know otherwise.
Yep. And among the other things they did is they adopted wholesale Bork's ideas about market concentration and market power.
Are they funded by corporate interests?
Well, it's almost that. Do they need to be? I mean, at the time, you know, I mean, the University of Chicago had this large endowment and they attracted all these scholars. Certainly, you know, I mean, Milton Friedman worked in all these different countries, worked in Chile and all over the world, practically, preaching this gospel, which, you know, fit very well with the, you know, newly active ideas around corporations. You know, you think about the Lewis Powell memo in the 1970s and the idea that the corporation needed to exert its power in the political realm. Milton Friedman, of course, was a favorite of the Reagan administration. So, you know, I think there was a synergy there. I mean, right. I don't think you have to necessarily talk about funding. Colleges and universities get their funding from a variety of sources, but there was certainly a lot of back and forth, a lot of borrowing of ideas, a lot of use of academics, which we see to this day, use of academics through funding to write reports favorable to business. And then, you know, it's just a very cozy relationship.
I know this sounds paranoid, but if you do read the Powell memo, Lewis Powell wrote this memo for the Chamber of Commerce going after right. Ralph Nader and young kids and telling corporations to fund think tanks and create
right.
pro-business propaganda. When you hear that there are tax advantages, I didn't know this, but that you just told me that there are tax advantages for somebody to take a publicly held newspaper, take it private, and then gut it. When I read that Clear Channel buys
right,
up
there's
all...
There's another roll-up. There's another large, concentrated media company.
That was, at one point, owned by Romney's Bain Capital.
Right.
And they have dumbed down the country while racking up debt, while not turning a profit, but
right.
they succeed in making the country dumber. I'm not paranoid, but I do think people are out to get me. But you describe local TV news as the number one source of news for most Americans. Is it conceivable that the Republicans are so terrified that people are going to be informed that they've all chipped in to destroy our ability to learn?
Well, I mean, you know, I by way of answering the question, let me just give this very interesting, instructive example that we're seeing here in real time. Because it disrupts the notion that that these corporations are just out to make a profit, and they're ruthless, and you know, and all they care about is that last dollar, and that protects us, the public, because they'll compete against one another, et cetera, et cetera. So, you know what's going on at MSNBC, right?
Well, tell me.
So MSNBC, we know under the Bush administration, Keith Olbermann became... almost by accident became this sort of celebrated figure on the left. They built up their roster of left-leaning commentators and news people. And they continued that through some of the Obama administration. And now it's the Trump administration, and they have a new person in charge, this guy Andy Lack, who is an executive who he seems incredibly disinterested in maintaining MSNBC's position sort of on the ideological spectrum as sort of a left counterweight to Fox News. So, you know, over the last several months, they have fired several hosts who were sort of left-leaning contributors to the network. They've hired Hugh Hewitt. It looks like they're going to put him in a show, a weekly show, to host. They've hired George Will. They've hired, they've given a show to Nicole Wallace, who is was served on the communications staff with Sarah Palin. They have sought to rebrand and move to the right, or at least to the center. And the problem with this is that if you look at MSNBC's ratings, they are outpacing Fox in the coveted 25 to 54 demographic among their remaining left-leaning hosts, Rachel Maddow, Chris Hayes, Lawrence O'Donnell. Those hosts are doing extremely well in the Trump era, as one would expect, given, you know, the sort of feeling in the air and how Trump, you know, sort of brings these headlines. But Andy Lack is going against the very ideas that the network should go with what is doing well. In fact, Lawrence O'Donnell's contract is up in like 3 weeks, and he has not even been talked to about renewing that contract. He's the number two person in cable news right now. And it looks like they're going to let him go. We remember that during the early days of the Bush administration, before Keith Olbermann stumbled upon this formula, Phil Donahue was the number one host at MSNBC, and he got fired for talking about the Iraq War.
Didn't Rosie have a show, too?
I think she might have. So if it was corporations only look out for their self-interest, and if something is making money for them, that's what they're going to do, then you would see the building up of hosts in similar ideological interest as Rachel Maddow, Chris Hayes, Lawrence O'Donnell. Yeah. You're seeing the exact opposite at MSNBC, and it shows that it's not just about this corporate drive for profit. It's that there's a corporate class, right? And it's more important to be beholden to that corporate class and to be, you know, show fealty to that corporate class, at least in the business of television news, than it is to make money.
Is it just the corporate class, or is it about making money?
One will facilitate the other. I mean, you might give up a couple ratings points here, but maybe your advertisers will come aboard to decide, you know, that you're, you know, fighting the good fight by getting rid of those left wingers off the television dial. Or maybe it's just that you'd rather put out news into the world that helps the cause of getting some large tax cut down the road. So your personal interests outweigh the interests of the corporation in this case. So I just think it's a really instructive kind of example of how this idea, and, you know, this is part of the Bork idea, is that, you know, corporations are ruthless, they'll go for their profit, and we don't have to worry about them, you know, jacking up prices or doing all of these things, because they will compete because the free market, the invisible hand of the free market will surely spread these benefits to everybody. But it's not true.
Yeah, I was listening to Bernie talk the other day. I don't know what your politics are. I suspect they're similar to mine. And everything Bernie says is spot on. And I thought, here he is on Meet the Press. The only way Bernie would ever be allowed on Meet the Press is almost becoming president. He was so undeniable that they had to put him on. And when they put him on, they couldn't shut him up because he almost became president.
And Bernie Sanders had a 25-year career prior to running for president, where he probably appeared on a Sunday morning show two times in that 25 years. So that sort of answers your question.
Is it the fairness doctrine that needs to be brought back, or would that fix it? I doubt it, right?
Yeah, I don't know if it's the fairness doctrine, but it is about, you know, in the look at the Sinclair case, for example. So, like I said, they wouldn't have been able to buy Tribune if it weren't for changes in FCC law. The already rolled back media ownership rules say that no company can own more than 39%, can own stations nationwide that broadcast to 39% of the country. But then they came up with this thing that they call the UHF discount. And the UHF discount was rolled back a long time ago. And what it said was is that, well, if you have a UHF station, you know what, you remember UHF, that was the high stations on the dial. That
antenna TV.
Well. Yeah, in over-the-air television. If you had a UHF station, you can only count half of the UHF stations you have towards this 39% number. So the new FCC under Trump's hand-picked chairman, Ajit Pai, reinstated the UHF discount in a time where practically everyone gets their television through a cable signal, and there's no such thing as a UHF station that is high on the dial and inaccessible, and you know, it's ridiculous to bring back the UHF discount in this day and age. Mm-hmm. But what that did for Sinclair was it immediately brought their calculation of how much of the nation they cover from 39% to 25%. So it immediately gave them more headroom to buy more stations. And that's exactly what they did, first buying some stations in New York and then buying Tribune. Now, the assumption is now they've gotten so many stations that they're going to have to divest of some of them. However, Ajit Pai is talking about relaxing media ownership rules even further. The UHF discount was just the beginning of what he wants to do. And I suspect that by the time the Sinclair Tribune deal closes, that they won't have to divest of any of these stations. They will come up with some other reason why they can hold on to all of them. And you just see the concentration happen further and further and further and further and further. And when you put that into the perspective of Sinclair made these deals to help Trump get elected, and now Trump's FCC is making policy to help Sinclair buy more stations and concentrate their control over the television industry, you begin to understand why this is so troubling. And even in a week last week where, you know, you had the firing of James Comey and all of these, hue and cry about the office of the presidency and what's become of it, I really thought the Sinclair deal was the most ominous thing that we saw last week, even more so than that fire.
You said the CEO of Sinclair rode in the presidential motorcade, and it reminds me of Clear Channel under the George W. Bush administration. They're from San Antonio, and they were in bed with the Bush administration. 39% of the market share? They have to have certain...
Of households. 39% of all households.
And is that
right? So households that are available to watch television. So let's say there are 100 million households in the country. They could only broadcast to areas where 39 million households could access them, in theory. But because of this UHF discount, that changes that. You know, the calculation is this sort of customized calculation that only they have to deal with.
Right. One of the things they do is they'll buy a couple of stations and run one to the ground. They'll just turn it into a shell.
Right.
To save money, and because one fewer station to compete against. These are owned by the American people.
Well, the airwaves are, sure. And we sell those airwaves in spectrum auctions all the time. And that money goes into the U.S. Treasury. But we don't put as many conditions on that purchase as we used to. And you know, the idea that these stations operate in the public interest, they're supposed to provide public sources of information, part of the Fourth Estate, part of, creating a well-informed citizenry, all of those things have really gone out the window, and the public interest has been subsumed, you know, purely by commerce. And that is a tremendous change that we've seen in this country over the last, 30, 40 years. Look who we've gotten from a public policy standpoint after that change was made.
In The Nation, you have a piece about Jonathan Taplin's new book, Move Fast and Break Things, how Facebook, Google, and Amazon cornered culture and undermined democracy. Mm-hmm. Do we need to break up Facebook, Google, and Amazon? I mean, when you look
I believe so.
Yeah.
I do believe so. And, you know, Google has sort of reoriented themselves. They now are called Alphabet, right? And they have all these separate business lines under Alphabet. And so it's almost that Alphabet has given us the tool by which to break up Google into all these different business lines. And I think the first thing you have to do with respect to Google is sever the relationship between the search engine and the advertising outlet. When Google bought DoubleClick, which was a big online advertising company, that was the beginning of the end right there, because now you have a company where they control the platform. They're a what is known as a platform monopoly. They control the platform for search engines. So virtually all search happens through Google. And they control the advertising. So if people are searching for a product or searching for an entertainment option, and the same company where they're searching, you know, the same storefront, also manages as a gatekeeper who can advertise to those people. This is why the profits of Google, in terms of gross revenue, have gone up in a straight line year after year, and now are over $74 billion. They obviously have this massive concentration. They buy a company a week. If they don't have it in-house, they purchase it. You see a company like Amazon. They also are a platform monopoly for e-commerce. They invite all these other companies to sell things on their platform in their store, and these other companies have no other choice to reach people than to go on Amazon. And Amazon collects all the data that is in terms of what people are purchasing on their website, and they use that data to build competitors to these very people who are coming on their platform to sell products. The same with Google, collecting the data of all of their customers and using that to sell it to advertisers. That's actually, as much as it is the advertising itself, that's the source of the revenue, is to sell these customized ads based on everything you do online, that and Facebook does this as well, to you know, give premium spots for advertisers that are dynamic, that are based on, they can be based on where you are walking in the neighborhood that you live in, and they can say, hey, here's a coupon for a pizza shop that you're about to hit in 10 seconds because I know where you are because of your geolocation data on your Google phone. Mm-hmm. This is where we're getting to. You know, what Taplin's book is really talking about is cultural. He was the tour manager for the band in the late 1960s and 1970s. He then became an executive. He worked with Sony. He's produced films for people like Martin Scorsese and Wim Wenders. He has an insight into what happened in the music and movie business in terms of when the Googles and the Facebooks and the Amazons of the world came in and what they've done to the ability for non-superstar artists to make a living. And he tells this story about Levon Helm, who was the great drummer for the band, and how at the end of his life, he had to give concerts at his house to pay for his medical bills.
Wow.
While, you know, corporate executives were making untold amounts of money off songs from the band. So,
is that because what they do is they change the technology
Well, he describes a number of factors. Number one, obviously, is, file sharing and Napster and things like that. But it's also the fact that Google's YouTube, for example, practically every song known to existence is streamable at the touch of a button with YouTube. And royalties from, this was an amazing statistic, I couldn't believe it. In 2015, royalties from vinyl were higher as overall number than royalties from streaming like YouTube.
What do you mean by that?
I mean that artists in the aggregate received more money as a percentage of vinyl record sales in 2015 than they did from streaming. Streaming on YouTube represents 52% of all streaming of music that is done, and something like 4 or 10% of the profits from streaming. Google has this tremendous power to digitize all of this information and then not pay the artists back, even though they're attaching ads to these pieces of music, for example, or movies or whatever. So the changes in technology, as you describe, is exactly it. The money does not flow through to the artists in streaming, whether you're talking about Spotify or whether you're talking about YouTube or whether you're talking about any of these sort of next level kind of sources of income. And superstar artists can handle it. They can make their own deals. They can come up with innovative ways to make sure they're getting paid. But below that level, it becomes almost impossible to survive as an artist in this day and age. And, we've returned to sort of a traveling troubadour kind of lifestyle, where the only way that you can really keep that living going is by playing endless gigs. And the money, if somebody is making money off of this music that's playing out there in the world, it's just not the artists.
Is there any way to audit Google and find out what they're making off a Levon Helm song?
Right. I mean, we know that they're making little to nothing. And if you ask them, they'll say, well, this is what the market will bear. The problem is that whereas, Tower Records had 1,000 CDs in it or something, let's just use a round number. Well, Google has everything like that's mm-hmm. ever been digitized or ever been put to down on a tape, and so they don't have to take more than a tiny portion of each song and still make billions and billions of dollars. But for that artist out there that's competing with every other song in the known universe, they're simply not going to make that kind of volume. It's spread out over everybody,
So what does Taplin, what does he say has to be done?
He talks about using the antitrust laws to break up these companies, to make sure that your data, which is so lucrative. I mean, he calls these resource extraction companies. And it's not oil, it's data. That's what they're making their money from. And he says that should be able to be either freed, or that should be there should be opt-outs not give up their privacy.
I know I've taken up a lot of your time, but very quickly, I always hear about they're getting consumer data and that's worth a fortune. What do they have on me that would be worth anything?
They have every email you've ever typed. They have every website you've ever visited. They have every Google search you've ever made. You're more intimate with your computer than you are with anyone in your life. You will ask to search for things on your Google search that you would never say out loud. They have a tremendous amount of information on you.
And what is that?
That can be used
for what?
To format for a particular advertiser that's looking for a particular type of person to you know, move this particular message and marketing toward. So it's tremendously lucrative on the part of these platform monopolies. And let me just say one more thing that Taplin points out, and I think it's really, really important. He says that the patents that Google has or Facebook has for all of these different innovations should, the way Bell Labs was in the 1950s, there was a famous court case in the 1950s. AT&T was a monopoly. They ran all the phone service throughout the country. And the Justice Department said, all right, well, you can do that, but you have this arm called Bell Labs where you're coming up with new innovations and ideas all the time. All of the patents for Bell Labs, what you're coming up with, need to be able to be licensed by any company for a nominal fee. And what this did was create the electronics industry in America. It created what eventually led to the Internet in America. It created all sorts of positive benefits for society, and it created the very competition that inevitably led to what we see today in many of these markets. So if you did the same thing to Google, so they're trying to make these self-driving cars. All right, well, the patents for that now can be licensed to any company, and every company can have this self-driving car technology, and they can build a market, and they can compete with one another on price and quality and quality of service. And Google doesn't get to just hold on to that. That is one of the key recommendations that Taplin makes, and I think it's a very important one.
Wow. I'm kind of all over the map about the future. My new hope is we have a guaranteed income, and mm-hmm. that all of us are given a robot who goes out and does something, makes a little money for us, and then whatever the robot can't do, the government fills in the gap. And then the rest of us spend our waking hours consuming for the corporations. Instead of working for the corporations, our job is to consume, buy things, eat things, right. and convince ourselves that we're artists.
Right. I think there's almost two strains of thought on this. There's the idea of a universal basic income, and then there's the idea of a job guarantee. And I guess what I've gone back to is, what's the first thing we say to a child when you meet a child? You say, what do you want to be when you grow up? I think there's an inherent value still in this country to the value of work that you would have to get over in order to really reorient society in the way that you're talking about. I also think that there's a lot of work to do. You know, the idea that robots are going to come on board and you know, displace all of the jobs in the country is, number one, not borne out by experience. I mean, we went from punch cards to the personal computer, and somehow we still have these tremendous needs within the country. We have infrastructure that's absolutely falling apart. If you're going to put together self-driving cars, you are going to have to engage in the biggest road project in the history of mankind to fix every road in America to make sure that it's available for use for a self-driving car, because they're simply too haphazard. We have roads that don't have the lines painted on them. We have you know, in some more rural areas, dirt roads, gravel roads. You're going to need to you know, make some of the infrastructure uniform in order to ensure self-driving cars can actually operate. And if you do that, you're talking about the largest infrastructure project in the history of mankind. So yeah. I just don't believe that there's nothing left to do, or that there will be nothing left to do in the next century, let's say. Maybe after that we can talk, but I just don't think that I think that a better idea is to say, if you need a job, the government is willing and able to step in to give you that job. And that job and whatever you're going to be working toward will benefit the public at large, whether it's a, you know, WPA style kinds of things that we saw, Civilian Conservation Corps and the New Deal, or it's, you know, these construction and road projects that need to be done to ensure that we have, you know, are available to move around.
I agree with you 100%. And I blame the Republicans. They just refuse to invest properly in our economy. It's a sickness. Their justification is rooted in fallacy. That being said, I do believe that 100 years from now, we will talk about America's puritanical sloth ethic. And that we will celebrate doing nothing. That people can't...
I'm all for it, because it's a lot of what I do in my personal life. But I'm not sure that... I mean, look at it this way. The one area of the country where you see a lot of sloth and a lot of you know, inability to have a job is in these areas that have this terrible opioid crisis, mm-hmm. and it creates this despair. You know, obviously, if you're getting a universal basic income, maybe that you know, that those idle hands don't necessarily go toward, you know, this very tragic situation. But I fear that it does. I fear that there's this need in human nature, and it's really a question about human nature, right? For, you know, some project of self-worth to point to and be able to say that you are making a contribution. And if we get away from that, I'm concerned about what that unleashes.
Well, you're a writer, and nobody has a greater work ethic than a writer. A writer is haunted every second of the day. I should be writing. I should be writing. I should be productive. Should be writing. I'm not writing. I'm right. But most people are very comfortable lying on their back, playing a video game, watching television, thinking about food, thinking about shopping. I genuinely believe that jobs and the idea of work is a new idea. Maybe it's a couple hundred years old.
Mm-hmm.
Most Americans, given the choice, will easily, I'd say most people I know would say, if I had to go to work or if I had to sit and binge watch Netflix, I'll choose Netflix. That's what's being offered. And we're getting into inception territory where people will take the drug or the video.
But see, I think that's a problem.
I do too, but most people don't.
Right.
Well, anyway, this is great. This has been so much fun. David Dayen writes for two of my favorite periodicals, The Nation, which you need to subscribe to and donate money to it, and The Intercept, Glenn Greenwald's magnificent internet news gathering operation. They do real investigative journalism. It's a great resource for just figuring out what's going on. And David Dayen, you could not have been more generous with your time. Please come back.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you.